Good morning, good morning. The time for convening has arrived. The Senate will come to order. At this time, I ask all unauthorized visitors to please exit the chamber. Wow, we got a lot of pages today. I recognize the senator from the 28th. A reading of the journal and the introduction of our pages.
Good morning, Mr. President. We appreciate y'all being here. I know it's hard for you to take a day off from school, but we do appreciate it. Mr. President, I do want to notify you that on this day in 1923, the U.S. President Warren G. Harding became the first president to pay taxes. So I hope you, being president of this body, you pay your taxes.
It's hard to get around those things, Senator.
It is. Mr. President, the journal has been read and found to be correct.
Thank you, Senator. And there was quite a few pages from the Senator from the 24th District, wasn't it? Strong representation. So, glad to have all the pages here today. Glad to have you all here. Appreciate you being here. Is there objection to dispensing of the reading of the journal? Chair hears none. The reading of the journal is dispensed with. Is there objection to confirmation of the journal? Chair hears none, and the journal is confirmed. All senators who have bills and resolutions to introduce, please bring them to the secretary's desk at this time. First reading and reference to Senate bills and resolutions. Secretary?
House Resolution 1215 by Representative Jaspers of the 11th and others. Speaker David E. Ralston, Interstate Connector, Fannin County. Dedicate. That completes the order, Mr. President.
It is now time for the morning roll call. Are there any motions to excuse? Recognize Senator from the 33rd.
Thank you, Mr. President, and good morning, y'all. I ask unanimous consent to excuse the following senators for business inside the Capitol. 5, 38, 39, 42, 22, and 55.
All right. Without objection, senators from the 5th, the 38th, the 39th, the 42nd, the 22nd, and the 55th. Our excuse. Recognize Senator from the 28th.
Thank you, Mr. President. I ask for unanimous consent to excuse the Senator from the 30th for business inside the Capitol.
Without objection, Senator from the 30th is excused. Recognize Senator from the 21st.
Unanimous consent to excuse the Senator from the 27th for business inside the Capitol.
Without objection, Senator from the 27th is excused. Recognize Senator from the 17th.
Pass unanimous consent to excuse the senator from the 16th and the senator from the 56th for business outside of the chamber.
56 right behind me, Senator.
Look here to me.
My tort reform champion, the judiciary chair.
I just want to make sure he was gone.
Right now, the senator from the 7th.
Mr. President, I ask for unanimous consent to excuse the senator from the 9th for business outside the Capitol.
Without objection, Senator from the 9th is excused. Any other motions to excuse? Secretary will call roll. Senator, signify your presence by voting the yay switch. Secretary will unlock the machine. senator from the 7th, for what purpose do you rise?
Mr. President, I ask for unanimous consent to excuse the senator from the 6th.
Time clock ran out on you, senator. But you can't. Senator from the 6th be excused. It is now time for morning devotion. All senators, please take your seats and cease all conversation. I would ask that the doorkeeper secure the chamber at this time. I now recognize the senator from the 56th to lead us in our pledge and introduce our chaplain of the day. Senator.
Thank you, Mr. President. Join me for the pledge of the American flag.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
And now the Georgia flag.
I pledge allegiance to the Georgia flag and to the principles for which it stands, wisdom, justice, moderation, and courage.
Good morning. It's a pleasure to introduce my pastor, Jamey Dickens, who is the lead pastor at East Cobb Church, a campus of North Point Ministries under the leadership of Andy Stanley, who has been here in the Senate chamber many times. A native of Atlanta and a graduate from the University of North Carolina, Jamey started his time in ministry as a missionary in Moldova, working to combat sex trafficking with nonprofits, which was sadly very prolific there at that time. Then he moved back to Atlanta and he joined the staff at Buckhead Church and helped them to grow to one of the largest student ministries in the city at that time. He also began speaking and writing for organizations around the country. He now lives with his wife and four kids in East Cobb as they together get to pursue one of their lifelong dreams, which is planting a church in the community they love. And on a point of personal privilege, Jamey is such an inspiration to my family and I. The way that he delivers messages and makes everyone welcome in East Cobb Church is extraordinary, and he always reminds us to love where we live. Jamey?
Well, good morning. So honored to be here. As a boy who grew up in not only in Georgia but in Atlanta and who spent most of my life here, it really is an honor to, if nothing else, to simply have the opportunity to say to every one of you, thank you. Thank you so much for leading us. Thanks for serving us. Thanks for fighting for us and fighting for our state. I truly think Georgia is extraordinary. I love our state and I love our city, and I've lived here most of my life. One of the things I like to do when I meet people or have friends who live elsewhere is ask them, hey, what do you know about Georgia? I like to ask them, what's Georgia famous for wherever you're from? And just listen to what they say, whether it's a stranger or somebody I know. And you get the, you know, you get the typical answers, like peaches, obviously. The Braves, everybody knows about the Braves. Atlanta traffic, I get that one a lot. You get the Masters, you get Bulldogs, Georgia Bulldog football. You get hip-hop, Chick-fil-A, stuff like that. The list goes on about what our state is known for, not just here, but around the country. And that is exactly the encouragement that I brought with me today to pass on to you. Perhaps it's an encouragement, perhaps it's simply a reminder, but it's this, that you would add to that list, or simply double down, perhaps, on being famous for something else, something specific. Something that I bet many of you already want to be famous for as senators and servants of our state. And something that is important to me as a pastor, because it is the thing that Jesus commanded the church to be famous for wherever it was. He famously said these words. He said, a new command I give you, that you must love one another. As I've loved you, so you must love one another. In fact, by this, everyone's going to know that you're my followers. This is what you're going to be famous for in the community, by how you love one another. And that's my encouragement for you today, or perhaps simply a reminder to you today, as we, all of us, head into to a season where we're all going to be tempted to put up our walls and throw rocks at each other. What if we, in addition to all the other things that we're famous for in this state, what if we became famous and were famous? What if you were famous for simply loving one another even when you disagreed with one another? What if you resolved in a fresh way to respect each other, do good to one another, esteem each other, take the high road with each other, serve one another, even when you found yourselves at times competing and contending with one another about stuff that really matters? What if you led the way in mastering the art of loving unconditionally while disagreeing politically? I think that would be extraordinary. And maybe, just maybe, it would be contagious to the rest of us as well. And it would be yet another reason why Georgia, in my humble opinion, is one of the greatest places to live on planet Earth. And so that's what I'm praying for you in this season and today as you legislate. I'm praying that you would love well at the same time as you're working and fighting really hard for the things that you care about and the things that we all care about and the things that really matter. So that's my prayer for you, whether it's big things and it's policy agendas, or maybe it's the simple little stuff like shaking someone's hand, writing a note of encouragement, giving an apology that's long overdue, or simply smiling, you know, instead of scowling. All those little things that are easy to say, but sometimes pretty hard to do. So that's what I'm praying for you. Thank you, thank you, thank you for what you do for us every single week. It's a really, really big deal, and we're very proud, and I'm very proud. Please let me pray for you as we begin our day. Heavenly Father, thank you for every woman and every man in this room. Thank you for their service to our community, for their sacrifice for our community, for the tenacity and their perseverance in advocating and fighting for things that really matter and that change our day-to-day lives. I'm so grateful. A simple prayer is this: God, would you give them wisdom to know what to do and courage to do it? Would you grant them your extraordinary supernatural wisdom to know what to do, what is best, what is right, and give them courage to do it no matter the cost, no matter the consequences? Would you bless them and their families and those they love? I ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
It is good to have a special guest with us today. Brian Blake, who is the president of Georgia State University, is here and doing a good job for us at Georgia State. And he's got his family with us. And I recognize the secretary to read the resolution first.
Senate Resolution 672 by Senator Anderson of the 43rd and others. A resolution recognizing and commending Dr. M. Brian Blake and for other purposes. Whereas, as the 8th president of the Georgia State University, Dr. Brian Blake leads the state of Georgia's largest university spanning 6 campuses and 53,000 students. Before coming to Georgia State University, he had over 22 years of faculty and administrative experience across 5 comprehensive research universities. And he has a Bachelor of Electrical Engineering from Georgia Institute of Technology, a Master of Science in Electrical Engineering from Mercer University, and a PhD in Software Engineering from George Mason University. Now, therefore, be resolved by the Senate that the members of this body recognize and commend Dr. M. Brian Blake and thank him for his efficient, effective, unselfish, and dedicated public service to the state of Georgia, and extend the most sincere best wishes for continued health and happiness. That completes the order, Mr. President.
Is there objection to the adoption of the resolution? Chair hears none, and the resolution is adopted. I recognize the senator from Conyers, Georgia, to introduce our special guest.
Thank you, Mr. President. Good morning, colleagues. I am more than excited to present to you Dr. Blake. Most of you know that I'm an HBCU grad, but my upper degree, one of them, came from Georgia State. Under the direction of our new president, Dr. Blake, the first black president after 120 years in the history of Georgia State. This is an honor for me. His track record, of course, precedes him, and he has earned every accolade. He has earned every hurrah. He has earned every part of where Georgia State is right now. As he serves on many boards, the Grady Memorial Hospital Corporation, Metro Atlanta Chamber, Junior Achievement of Georgia, and the Atlanta Convention and Visitors Bureau, Dr. Blake has been included on the 2022 and 2023 lists of Georgia 500, the most influential leaders, as well as recognized as the 2023 most admired CEO. He is joined today. He's a native of Georgia. He's Savannah, from Savannah, Georgia. He has attended Benedictine Military Academy. He's with his wife, Bridget, one of his sons, and his father to celebrate this moment. Thank you, Dr. Blake, for being here with us, and please give us a few words.
Thank you so much, Senator Anderson. I really appreciate being here today. It's such a privilege and honor to be in front of this chamber. She introduced our family, but let me first thank my lovely wife, who's here, Dr. Bridget Blake. She's the best doctor in our household, so Dr. Bridget's here. I owe everything to her, so I'm just so happy she's able to join me here today. My father, the senior M. Blake, is here as well, Malworth Blake. And my son, my youngest son, Bryce, also joins us today, and he's very happy to be out of school. So so let me thank Lieutenant Governor Burt Jones, who actually has been such a supporter through his time and before. Senator Anderson, who gave such a great introduction as alumna of Georgia State and just been a great role model for our students, and did a fabulous job this year in the Veterans Day. So, and then all the members of this distinguished body, I'm really thankful to be in front of you today. Just profoundly grateful and humbled to get this. And many of you know I'm a native of Georgia, so getting to serve as president is just a dream come true for me, and one that I take a lot of pride in having. It's not just an honor for me, it's a testament for the collective efforts of our faculty, our administration, our students and staff that I'm privileged to both lead and serve. I'm incredibly proud that GSU as an institution, we for 110 years or more, we've been actually providing economic growth to the state of Georgia. We have the largest body of students that graduate, and we place 9 out of 10 of them right in Georgia. So I'm so happy for us to provide that sort of boost to the workforce. Today I'm also proud to have two of our dynamic students, I think they're here somewhere, I don't see them, but our current SGA president and rising junior political science major, Xavion Shepherd's here, and we also have the SGA president. Oh, there they go. And also James Wilson, he's our incoming SGA president and rising senior. So I'll just say along the way, it's been, you know, for me, I have a lot of gratitude to this body for your support of public higher education. Our Chancellor Sonny Perdue and his leadership and his support of myself as a president and the 26 other presidents in the University System of Georgia, we're just grateful to kind of be able to serve. So I think there's so many others I could thank as a part of this chamber. I had 3 minutes. I think I'm right at it. So thanks again for having me here, and go Panthers.
All right, good job. Good job, Dr. Blake.
It is a pleasure to have our Irish minister here today, just in time for St. Paddy's Day in Savannah, right, Senator? So, Secretary, read the caption.
Senate Resolution 753 by Senator Kennedy of the 18th and others, a resolution recognizing and commending Minister Peter Burke and for other purposes. Whereas first elected to the Dáil Éireann in 2016, Peter Burke represents the constituency of Longford Westmeath and serves Ireland as Minister of State for European Affairs and Defence. And whereas he will participate in the 200th Savannah St. Patrick's Day Parade, which represents a monumental historic milestone. And whereas he continues to serve the people of Ireland with honour and distinction, and his vision and unyielding commitment to excellence have set the standard for public service. Now therefore be it resolved by the Senate that the members of this body recognize and commend Minister Peter Burke upon his visit to the state of Georgia for his dedicated public service and extend the most sincere best wishes for continued health and happiness. That completes the order, Mr. President.
Is there objection to the adoption of the resolution? Chair hears none, and the resolution is adopted. Recognize the Senator from the 18th to introduce our special guest.
Thank you, Mr. President. Good morning, colleagues. You know, we have the honor of receiving a lot of distinguished guests and visitors here at the Capitol, and none are more fondly received than our friends from Ireland. And it is my distinct honor to get to introduce the minister here to you in just a moment. Much of what I was going to tell you about his public service and his education really were in the resolution, so I'm not going to take our time to double down on that, but you know, the strong ancestral and historic ties are beyond worthy of recognition of the Irish companies that employ approximately 7,000 people in Georgia, and they are the eighth largest source of foreign direct investment in the great state of Georgia. As was stated a moment ago, Minister Burke, it will be in Dr. Watson's, the senator from Savannah, the center from the first great parade that he is a great participant in this coming weekend. So the minister has timed it just perfectly. We've got some other guests on the floor with us as well at the rostrum here, the Consul General. But I'll let the Minister Burke introduce the folks that are with him. And y'all please give a great Georgia Senate welcome to our friends from Ireland.
Thank you, Lieutenant Governor. President pro tempore, senators, it's a privilege to be here with our team, our Consulate General Cuiva here behind me, Emer, Deputy Head, and our other colleagues here from Ireland. It's a privilege to get this opportunity. I thank President pro tempore, Senator John F. Kennedy, for the opportunity to facilitate me speaking to you here this morning, which we really value as a country. It's a relationship, the US-Ireland relationship, that we really put resources behind, that we treasure, and it's demonstrated by this week about 20 cities hit between 11 ministers right across the US. And also we have our Consulate General here in Atlanta since 2010, 9 missions here in the US, and the best evidence of a good bilateral relationship is that it works both ways. And when you see, as Senator John F. Kennedy just alluded to here, the FDI investment in Georgia, but 7,000 jobs really coming from Irish-backed companies, companies like CRH, like Curry, working on the ground here in Georgia. Obviously for St. Patrick's weekend, it's an incredible accolade for us to get the opportunity to speak to you here this morning to demonstrate the huge relationship borne out by about 9.5% of the US population, 32 million people claiming Irish heritage, a million people here in Georgia, that we really value that relationship and we really nurture it into the future. I want to thank you for that, for being good friends and for being there for us at very difficult times in the past, like the Good Friday Agreement, which was really assisted by the US. I just want to make two very brief points for our mission here in the US this week, which are very important to Ireland on the foreign policy perspective. Firstly, in relation to Ukraine, we believe it is critical that we stand by Ukraine for as long as it takes. As a member of the European Union, this is the first war in a generation on mainland Europe, a country's territorial integrity being challenged by Russian aggression, its right to self-determination, a direct challenge on the international rules-based order. And we really need to stand up to that. We've demonstrated by a 50 billion euro package from Europe to assist Ukraine with its public services. So I really, really encourage everyone to keep up the resilience to stand with the people of Ukraine for as long as it takes. And secondly, briefly, just to mention the Middle East. We really abhor the acts of October 7th on the State of Israel. We've demanded unequivocally the release of all hostages by Hamas, which is very important to the Irish government. But also we were one of the first parliamentary democracies to call for a ceasefire. And we really believe we need to avoid proportionality, collective punishment on a very vulnerable people, and get humanitarian corridors opened up as quickly as possible. I want to acknowledge and thank the US administration for working with its interlocutors in the region, of which it has a very strong voice, to encourage and secure that such important humanitarian corridors and a ceasefire, to ensure that we can get back to the two-state solution right to the very forefront of our policy. And finally, dear friends, very important date, August 24th, when Georgia Tech are coming to be victorious in the Viva Stadium in Ireland. So go Yellow Jackets. Thank you.
Moving on to the rules calendar. Secretary Reed, SR 687.
Senate Resolution 687, a resolution by Senator Gooch of the 51st, a resolution urging the University of North Georgia and the University System of Georgia Board of Regents to name a certain building after former Speaker David Ralston and for other purposes. The Senate Committee on Rules recommends that this resolution be passed by substitute. Respectfully submitted, Senator Brass of the 28th District Chairman. The Senate Committee on Rules offers the following substitute to Senate Resolution 687, a resolution urging the University of Georgia and the University System of Georgia Board of Regents to name a certain building after former Speaker David Ralston and for other purposes. Whereas this body shows its support for the University of North Georgia naming its new building after the late Speaker of the House of Representatives David Ralston in recognition of his outstanding contributions to the university and the state. And now, therefore, be it resolved by the Senate that this body urges the University of North Georgia and University System of Georgia Board of Regents to dedicate and name the new academic building at the university's Blue Ridge campus, David E. Ralston, and further purposes. That completes the order, Mr. President.
Recognize the Majority Leader to speak to the resolution.
Thank you, Mr. President. Good morning, colleagues. It's an honor for me to be here today, standing before you to present a Senate resolution that you have probably read before, but I did not need to remind you of the importance of the man that we'll be talking about here for a few moments, and that is the late former Speaker David Ralston. Some of us were out of the chamber earlier, and it's because we were attending the House ceremony that is being done this morning to honor the late speaker by unveiling the portrait that was commissioned by the University of North Georgia that will be hanging outside the front door of the House chamber of David Ralston. David Ralston, as most of you know, was a very independent, strong-willed North Georgian, somewhat like former Governor Zell Miller. If you served with Zell Miller, you know what an independent streak Zell had in him as well, and you could also compare Speaker Ralston's style and his ability to get things done and reach across the aisle to that of the late Speaker Tom Murphy, who served in that chamber for many, many years. In fact, Speaker Murphy served the longest of any other speaker in Georgia history. Speaker Ralston has served second longest in Georgia history. Both of those gentlemen graduated from the University of North Georgia, at the time was known as North Georgia College in Dahlonega, Georgia. So there's a lot of commonality between those two former speakers. Today we're honoring David Ralston. David Ralston was born in Ellijay. He graduated from the Gilmer County High School, and he continued his education there in North Georgia, North Georgia College, which is now known as University of North Georgia. Soon after he graduated from North Georgia College, he took a job as a reporter at the Gainesville Times. Some of you may remember some of his articles and some of the work that he did, often criticizing public policy and politicians and other topics of that nature. He later left that job as a reporter when he went over to a little school in Athens. He became a dog, where he earned his law degree and found his love for the University of Georgia as well as North Georgia College. He went back home to North Georgia, where he opened up his law practice, and that's where he lived the remainder of his life. He was living in Fannin County when he passed just a year and a half or so ago, and we have fond memories of him. We don't always agree with one another in this chamber, regardless of which party you're in, but I think we know that Speaker Ralston was firm and fair, and he was deliberate, and he had wisdom. With that wisdom came a lot of common sense, which was marinated with experience. And I think that was the words that we learned this morning listening to Governor Dill and the other governors in the chamber, Governor Kemp and Governor Perdue. All three spoke highly of David Ralston. Speaker Ralston served in the Georgia House of Representatives for 20 years. He was, again, the longest serving Speaker of the House, second only to Tom Murphy. He also served in this chamber. He was a state senator from 1992 until 1998 before receiving the Republican nomination for the Attorney General's position that he went after. He did not succeed in that race for Attorney General. So after a few years of considering other options, he went back and he ran for the House, and he served there for the remainder of his life. Speaker Ralston displayed visionary leadership and a bipartisan approach to legislation, enabling him to champion economic development in North Georgia and throughout the entire state. He was instrumental in several enhancements and expansion projects at the University of North Georgia. Some of the things that I've worked with David Ralston on personally, obviously, was broadband expansion throughout rural Georgia, healthcare expansion throughout rural Georgia, and of course, transportation throughout the entire state. He was a big champion for transportation investment funds for our transportation here in Georgia. Speaker Ralston is known as the father of the Blue Ridge campus, where we established a scholarship for nursing and political science students at the university at the Blue Ridge campus to where they could invest in their students of that community and communities surrounding Fannin County for those kids to pursue opportunities to serve others just like Speaker Ralston did. This resolution dedicates a new building that's currently being built on the Blue Ridge campus. It was a project that he personally engaged in just a number of years ago. He had the vision and the idea to expand the University of North Georgia into Fannin County, his hometown. We, as a Senate chamber, embraced that idea by putting funds into the state budget, not one time, but two times. We have built two buildings now, and this second building that is currently under construction will be named in honor of Speaker David Ralston. It will be named the David Ralston Hall. This resolution encourages the University of North Georgia and the University System of Georgia to approve that building being named in his honor. Mr. President, I'd like to ask for everyone in this building to pause for a moment of silence and stand and give your appreciation to the former speaker, David Ralston. Some of his family members are in the building. Some may be in the gallery, along with some of the community citizens from Fannin and Gilmer counties. So let's take a moment, if you don't mind.
Senators requested a moment of silence.
Thank you very much. And I'd like to, at this time, if it's appropriate, to recognize the Ralston family and the community that came down from the mountains to witness this event. So y'all give them a round of applause. Thank you. Mr. President, if there's no questions, I will yield the well and ask you to happily vote in favor of this resolution.
Thank you, Senator. I recognize Senator from the 37th. Senator, you have.
Thank you, Mr. President. I had the honor to serve with Speaker David Ralston for 18 years in the House. And I want to tell a very, very short story about how we became Speaker, because it speaks to the challenge all of us have to have the courage of our convictions. Before David Ralston became the Speaker of the House, he was the Chairman of the Judiciary Non-Civil Committee. And the fair, balanced approach he took to that, the way he ran committee meetings, is step by step, word for word, exactly how I endeavored to chair hearings when I chair them. I know that Senator from the 30th served with us there as well. Senator from the 30th was a very good friend of Speaker Ralston's as well. But what I wanted this body to hear, and what I wanted Georgians to hear, was that in 2009 we had a leadership crisis in the House of Representatives. I won't be too detailed in how I describe it, but the leadership crisis manifested itself with a leadership in the House that was erratic, not bringing honor in our chamber in personal and professional ways. And David Ralston, as chairman of the Judiciary Non-Civil Committee, had it pretty good. It would have been very easy for him to stay where he was and continue to serve and contribute as a House member and as a chairman. But in the 2009 session, he took it upon himself to stand against the existing Speaker of the House in a leadership challenge, because he believed that the House should operate with a level of dignity and trust and substance in what we did. And David Ralston stood against our existing Speaker, lost the leadership race, lost his chairmanship, was banished from his office in 132 in his very meaningful position, and sent across the street without a chairmanship in a office in the legislative office building overlooking a dumpster, because he believed that the dignity of the House and our leadership mattered that much. As things changed, as things progressed through the course of the next year, and having taken that stand in 2009, being willing to sacrifice what was good for him politically for what he thought was best for the state, the House in 2010 honored him with making him Speaker of the House, which, again, the service we talk about, the service we think about with Chairman former Chairman, then Speaker Ralston's well known across our state. But what allowed that to happen was a lesson for all of us. to have the courage of our convictions, that even when things don't look politically beneficial to us and things sometimes seem impossible, sometimes those fights are the fights worth having. And I'd like to thank my friend David Ralston for having that fight. As a young third-term member, watching all that go down, knowing there needed to be a change, needing somebody that had the stature and experience to stand up and do something about it, he was the one with the courage of his convictions to lose a chairmanship, lose his potential for influence, to do what's best for the state of Georgia, and he was rewarded by our members less than a short year later to be our speaker. So with that, I just wanted to say this was not a position that was handed to him, didn't come to him easily, but it came to him ultimately from the courage of his convictions to do what's best for the state, what was best for our house, and best for the citizens that we serve across the state of Georgia. I wanted to just say that in honor of my friend David Ralston. I know there's many that would have fond things to say, but with that, Mr. President, I yield the will.
I recognize the senator from the 53rd.
Thank you, Mr. President. Heard a lot about courage and conviction from the previous speaker. Majority leader referenced fierce independence. Well, I reckon the speaker and myself come from a similar bloodline. Because, senators, I rise today in a steadfast opposition to Senate Resolution 687. My fellow senators, I think to bring a comparison to who this man was, we should first look at one of the greatest Georgians to ever live. A man who is globally recognized as a symbol of justice. Who am I talking about? Martin Luther King Jr. A man, what did he say? He said an injustice anywhere was a threat to justice everywhere. Powerful words that we should think about as we vote for this resolution. Because this body is about to perpetually memorialize, in my opinion, one of the most corrupt Georgia leaders we'll ever see in our lifetimes. I first remember learning about a girl named Haley when I served in the chamber across the way. Haley was brutally raped, sodomized in her living room by a man her family trusted. That man was Jason Brothers, and he hired Speaker David Ralston as his attorney, not to defend him, but to protect him from justice. You see, for nearly a decade, this case rocked on, and Haley became terminally ill, never seeing justice. Her family once walked in on her in a bathtub with blood as she contemplated suicide. And you probably say, Senator, well, that's just one case. Where can you go with that? But no, there were several more. There was a case of a lady who lost her daughter in her arms as she bled out because a man was driving drunk, destroyed the woman's family. But she wasn't able to get justice because the man charged with the DUI hired Speaker David Ralston as his attorney. You see, there was a man named Derek Key who for 10 years delayed cases after molesting a 14-year-old child, being protected by David Ralston. Now, how did David Ralston do this? We heard about him being chairman of Judiciary Non-Civil. Well, back in 2006, there was a bill called Senate Bill 503. The man created the legislative leave and then profited off of it, making hundreds of thousands of dollars protecting people from justice. You see, the truth is hard to
Senator,
hear.
Senator,
Mr. President,
we got decorum, you know, rules here in this chamber. I think you've made your point, sir. So if you could just go ahead and wrap up, we'd be appreciative.
Mr. President, I know it's hard to hear, but there were thousands of case delays. And make no mistake, these egregious examples I've given is no semblance of morality. You see, we as lawmakers are supposed to protect the vulnerable, Mr. President. We're supposed to protect children. We're supposed to protect law enforcement officers. Think about the law enforcement officers who were assaulted and weren't able to get to justice because of this man. You see, the speaker turned a blind eye to what we as legislators know to be truth. And records show that after he was speaker, he did not attend another court case. You see, he had more than 164 clients, because if you're not trying those clients, you just pick up more and more of them. No court, less work. He had an operation. He was running an industry, Mr. President, and all he was using was a simple form letter, sending it to the court, referencing the code section that the man created in 2006.
Senator, not the time or place. Not the time or place.
Mr. President.
Go ahead and yield the will, Senator.
At your request.
Thank you, Senator.
Recognize the Senator from the 30th, point of personal privilege.
Mr. President, I'm going to honor the decorum of this body. Mr. President, I'm going to honor the decorum of this body and bring this back to a man I knew. When first elected to the House, I had the honor of sitting next to Speaker David Ralston. If you look down from the Speaker's podium to the far left, the rows start out big and they end up to two seats. Those two seats was Speaker Ralston and myself. His job was, according to Speaker Richardson, was to keep me in between the lines, and David said, I think you ran off into the ditch. But he was a great man, a great mentor, and a wonderful friend. The man cared about Georgia. The man cared about rural Georgia. He truly did an amazing job for this state. When you talk about someone that would work across party lines, if he needed something on transportation, he would go across, make sure that everything was taken care of for the whole state. It didn't matter if you were a Republican or a Democrat. What mattered to him was, were you a Georgian, and what could he do best for this state? I hate that I had to come and follow what I just heard, so I'm gonna leave it at this. As a former House member and former chairman of Public Safety Homeland Security that David Ralston appointed me to, I hope each and every one of you vote for this resolution, because he was a great leader for this state and someone I admire very much, and his family. I was with Mr. Speaker, or Mr. President, I yield the will.
Thank you, Senator. Recognize the Senator from the 33rd.
Thank you, Mr. President, my fellow senators, colleagues, friends, and y'all. I don't have my glasses. I just want to say that I think we all have a lot of respect for the speaker, the former speaker, Ralston, and I have a bill in his honor, Senate Bill 85, named after him, a veterans bill that's over there in the House now, and I need for all of us to come together so that we can pass that bill, Senate Bill 85, and show the respect and honor that we have for Speaker Ward Ralston, and that bill is named after him. Thank you. We need everybody's support in getting that bill passed. It's a good veteran bill and it's named after him, and I yield the well, and God bless his soul.
Recognize Senator from the 14th.
Thank you, Mr. President. I rise today specifically because I am a Democrat, and I served under Speaker Ralston for 4 years in the House. And I want to join with the majority today in expressing my appreciation for how he served. I've spoken from this well before about the kind of heartburn you get when you're in the minority in this General Assembly, both houses, House and Senate to some degree. And you learn quickly you don't get what you want all the time. And I know there are a lot of speakers today, and I won't be super long-winded, but what I will say is that there was a measure of caring about the institution of the General Assembly and the House that Speaker Ralston held dear that made it worth it for everybody to serve, including Democrats, even when you didn't get what you wanted. And there was a way that he communicated respect and dignity in the institution that when we talk about hyperpolarization, when we talk about the ways that partisanship is threatening the United States, what he carried and held dear and communicated to members of both of his party and the opposition was the antidote to that. And it had such a resounding and lasting effect on so many of us that you see, even now, the Ralston legacy hard at work in the House, and you see it in the inspiration that members of both parties still bring to serve, including me. And I'm proud to be part of that legacy. And if there's any ambiguity about how many of us Democrats feel in the House and in this body, I just wanted to make it 100% clear that this is a bipartisan resolution for a great man. Thank you, Mr. President. I yield the well.
Recognize the Senator from the 18th.
Thank you, Mr. President. Good afternoon now, colleagues. I had not intended on speaking, but with what we've heard this morning, I feel compelled to address this body as the pro tem. You know, there's an old expression, there's a time and place for everything, but I think I've just learned there's not a time and a place for everything. And this well is a sacred place that under our rules and the way we conduct ourselves, you'd come down here and express yourself. But there are decorum limitations on that. And I thank our president for exercising those and recognizing those. Because I express and suggest that so many in this room that have talked to me in the last few minutes, there's a sincere embarrassment over the conduct of the Senate of the 53rd. And for that, on behalf of this body, as the pro tem, to the family and friends of David Ralston, I apologize. I apologize for that conduct. I'm going to pivot now because of the story that seemed to be told by the senator from the 53rd that spoke to David Ralston as a lawyer. Most everyone has come down here and talked about David Ralston as the significant public servant in Georgia, how he served in the Senate, how he offered himself for Attorney General, how he rose with the trust of his colleagues to be the Speaker of the House for a long time. He conducted himself with honor in that way, and he also did in the way I saw him practice law. Years ago, back in the early 90s, David Ralston and I had a case against each other. I was not in politics and hadn't even thought about being in politics. But I was living and practicing law in Gainesville, and he was up in Blue Ridge. And we had a will contest case. It was one of those that's difficult because it's families against families and a will that was offered. And I saw a man that exhibited great professionalism in the way he practiced law. Even though we were against each other, and we had families that were this was very heated and very serious for the families. David Ralston conducted himself very professionally. I'll tell you one little part of the story. We had depositions that needed to be taken up in Nashville, and David and I were talking, and David and I got along because he was the consummate professional when it came to being a lawyer. And he said, John, how are you going to get to those depositions? I said, well, I'm going to fly up there and be there for the day. He said, that's a long way to go to drive from Gainesville to Atlanta and fly to. I said, well, no, David, I'm a pilot. I'm going to rent a plane. I'm going to fly myself up there. And he said, wow, that sounds convenient. I said, you want me to come pick you up? It was a long pause, and he said, would you do that? I said, sure. Now, you got to understand the mindset. Not every lawyer would want to do that for every other lawyer, but David Ralston behaved himself and conducted himself with that degree of decorum and professionalism that I, as opposing counsel, not only was comfortable with that, but wanted to do that. So I flew out of Gainesville, flew up to Blue Ridge, or the closest little airport to Blue Ridge, landed. David was there. He got in the plane. We flew to Nashville. And as we were going to the place for the deposition, which was in a tall building in Nashville, I said, David, we might not ought to walk in together. Maybe our clients don't need to see us walking in absolutely together. He said, you know, that's a good idea, John. So one of us walked in first, and about 5 minutes later, the other did. And we went in, and we had an incredibly tense deposition. Again, family matters. We fought professionally. We objected. We argued. We represented zealously our clients. And at the end of that, everyone parted ways. David and I got in a cab and drove to the airport together. I flew him from Nashville back to the airport where he was, and as we were landing, it was getting dark, and we were later than I thought we were going to be. And this was the day before everybody had a cell phone. So I pulled up and I said, David, I'm not going to shut the engine down. I want you to just hop out. I'm going to leave the engine running. I need to get out of here and get out of the mountains before it gets dark. I said, but this is my wife's phone number. Would you call her as soon as you can and let her know that I'm running late, but I'm okay? Absolutely. He hops out. Everything was fine. I get home to then learn the story from my wife, who had told me that the phone rang. And she was my wife's always been nervous about me flying, like the senator's from the 19th a little bit. He flies as we have other members. But wives get nervous about us guys flying. And she said the phone rang and this deep voice said, Mrs. Kennedy. She said, yes. Susan Kennedy. Yes. Well, by this time, my wife had concluded in those 5 seconds that this was the FAA calling, that I had crashed and I was dead and she was being called to come identify the body. He said, this is David Ralston. I flew with your husband today. I'm just calling to tell you that he's going to be late, but he's going to be fine. So it ended well, but there in those moments, it certainly scared the heck out of her when David Ralston, the voice that he had, came and said that. David was a fine lawyer. He was a professional. And he was a good legislator. He was a good speaker. And he was a friend to so many of us. And I thank the majority leader for bringing this resolution. And I hope we get a nice, good vote for the family. Yes. And honoring his family. And with that, Mr. President, I yield the will.
Thank you, Senator. Does any other senator wish to speak for or against the measure? Chair hears none. Is there objection to the previous question being ordered? Chair hears none. The previous question is ordered. Questions on the adoption of the committee substitute. Is there objection to the adoption of the committee substitute? Hearing none, the committee substitute is adopted. Is there objection to agreeing to the report of committee which is favorable to the adoption of the resolution? Chair hears none. The report of committee is agreed to. Is there objection to the main question being ordered? Chair hears none. The main question is ordered. The question is on the adoption of the resolution by substitute. All those in favor of the resolution vote yay. Opposed nay. Secretary will unlock the machine.
On the adoption of resolution by substitute, the yeas are 53, the nays are 1. This resolution having received the requisite constitutional majority is therefore adopted by a substitute. Pro Tem, I appreciate you saying those words. I will tell you, members, I've served under two lieutenant governors in this body as a state senator, and I've served, this is my second year as lieutenant governor, and I give everybody in this room a lot of levity, a lot of leeway on when they come to the well, because I do believe everybody deserves the right to speak their mind on things. And I can assure you, in the 10 plus years I've been in this body, I have not liked everyone that I've served with, but I've always treated them with respect and decorum, which I think is necessary, and that's what I expect out of every one of our members here, whether it's majority or the minority party. And there is a time and a place for everything. And while I don't like cutting members off from speaking their mind, once again, there's a time and a place for everything. So let's be mindful, be respectful, and know whatever personal grievances you might have, pick and choose when you choose, when you pick the moment in time when you want to express those feelings, because today was not one of them. So. Recognize Senator from 26.
Thank you, Mr. President, and members of the Senate. This has been a 12-year battle for me. This is a good start, but let me say something to you. Checkers is a fast game. When you play at chess, when you make one move, you got to calculate where you got to make the other move. Thanks to the lieutenant governor, and I even said thanks to the chairman of regulators. I was a teacher. I spoke to his class when he was in high school. Now the student has come back to teach the teacher. This is serious business. I've been around here a long time. Now I've had many conversations with a lot of you, and I've tried to tell you, but this is the process. It's a tedious process. But we can get it done. But first, we got to send them something. And I know they're gonna object to it. That's part of the process. But then the discussion will take place, a real discussion about Medicaid expansion. Mr. President, I yield the way.
Thank you, Senator. Recognize the Senator from the 4th. Thank you, Senator. The Minority Leader, you the last on the list. Leader. So close us out strong so we can go to lunch.
Thank you, Mr. President, members of the Senate, and in many cases we have discussed, and in some cases we have cussed back and forth for 14 years, and you know, next year I won't be here, but I don't want to see you fussing and cussing for another year. So let's put this question to bed. Let's expand Medicaid and give our people, our rural hospitals, and our entire healthcare system the health that they need. Mr. President, let's do this. I yield well.
Thank you, Senator. Recognize the Senator from the 46th to close debate.
Thank you, Mr. President. I'll be brief. First of all, Senator from the 26th, I never taught you anything, but I have learned a lot from you. Watch you every day in your 49 years in this legislature have been well spent, and you have it figured out. And one thing you know is you want to promote this debate on Medicaid expansion, or how we're going to solve this problem with uninsured Georgians. There's been a lot of argument here today. You have promoted that debate today, and I have promised you I'm going to give you a hearing on your bill in our committee to further flesh that out as this conference committee deals with it. You can't get everything you want in one bill. Don't just pout and take your ball and go home because you don't get full Medicaid expansion in this CON bill. And I strongly urge as much support as you can for this bill. You don't have to like all 100% of it, but if you like 75%, get on board. Get on the train here as we move out of the station. Thank you, Mr. President. I yield the will.
Thank you, Chairman, and good job. All those in favor of the bill will vote yay, opposed nay. Secretary will unlock the machine. On the passage of the bill, the yeas are 43 and the nays are 11. This bill, having received requisite constitutional majority, is therefore passed by substitute. Good job, Chairman. And the Senator from the 26th is a wise, wise legislator. It is a game of chess up here, not checkers. All right, we're going to take a little break here, take a little lunch break, about 30 or 40 minutes. We've got two more bills left. I think one might have a little more debate, but I think everybody can have a little time, stretch their legs, get a sandwich. I know the pro tem's got food if y'all haven't already eaten it, but we'll stand in recess for about 30 minutes. Thank you.